Hello children, I welcome you back to our virtual learning platform, and today we are going to deal with chapter number 2 in history. You remember we started with chapter number 2 in our previous lecture? Yes, I hope you remember the lesson's name. If not, try to remember. I am giving you some time. Okay. You remembered? Good. Good, you remembered. Yes. What was the lesson's name? It was New King and Kingdoms. Yes. What did we learn about in that particular chapter? We did learn about everything. Yes. Regarding how the kings, they established themselves in a more new manner. What all new strategies did they apply for their administration to run? What all titles they engraved upon themselves? Yes, we did study about all this. Yes, children. So, going ahead, we will have a quick revision of what we have done in our last lecture, plus we will study what more the chapter has to offer us in detail. So let us slide ahead. So here the chapter number 2 reveals its name, which we had studied earlier in our first part also, New Kings and Kingdom. Let us have a quick recap, children, about the points which we went through in detail in our previous lecture. But here we will have a quick revision of what points we did cover in the last lecture. So the first point is the emergence of new dynasties. The emergence means the starting of new dynasties. Over here, we studied in the 7th century, we found big landlords or warrior chiefs in different regions of the subcontinent. Now, during that time, the existing kings, they acknowledged them as the subordinates or samantas. Clear? Now, what the subordinate and samantas were expected to do? They were expected to bring gifts to their kings. And they have to be present in the king's court, and they have to provide the king with the military support. So here we understood that the samantas or the subordinates were being given importance by the king. And these samantas were who? They were the big landlords or warrior chiefs. Clear? Now, what did we study in the last lecture about samantas? We did study that samantas gained power and wealth. How they became rich as they were in contact with the kings. Okay. So as the samantas gained power and wealth, they declared themselves, named themselves as Mahasamanta or Mahamandaleshwara. Remember these words we did in the last lecture? Mahasamanta or Mahamandaleshwara means what? The great lord of the circle or the region. And sometimes they asserted their independence from their overlords. Overlords means kings. Means we studied in 6th standard, children, where we studied if the king became weak, the Samanta used to separate himself from the king and he used to establish his own kingdom. Correct? We did study this about this in the last standard, that is our 6th standard. Clear? And we in the last lecture we went through an example also where we studied about the example of Rashtrakuta dynasty that was in Deccan. Clear? So earlier the Rashtrakuta dynasty were the subordinate of the Chalukya dynasty. how the Samanthas were subordinate to the kings, right? Same like that, the Rashtraputas in Deccan, they were the subordinates to the Cholas in the Karnataka, sorry, the Chalukyas in the Karnataka. Clear? Now, there was a king in the mid 18th century, there was a king, Dante Durga. We did this in our last lecture. What did he do? He was from the Rashtrakuta dynasty, Dante Durga. He overthrew the rule of the Chalukya king by performing a ritual named Hiranyagarbha, that is the golden womb. Okay. Then, while he performed that sacrifice, it meant that he himself becomes a Kshatriya, even though he was not a, or he is not a Kshatriya, one by birth. Okay. If he is not a Kshatriya by birth, but by performing this ritual, he becomes a Kshatriya. So, we did about this, how the new dynasties emerged. Then, what all did we study next? We did study about the emergence, about the new dynasties, and we did more study about the Pallava dynasty as well. Clear? The Pallava dynasty we saw in the warfare for the wealth. Next, we studied about the administration in the kingdoms. What do you understand by administration in the kingdoms, children? Yes, what did you understand by that? Can you tell me? We did this in our last lecture. Administration in the kingdoms, you remember? No? Oh, yes. If yes, let us have a quick review. How were the these kingdoms were administered? How were they, how they ran during that period of time? So, many of the kings, during that period, they adopted the title of Maharadhiraja, that is a great king. Remember, in standard 6th, Chandragupta Maurya, he adopted from his grandfather. Clear? So Maharaja Adhiraja was a weightage of that particular name. Clear? The great king or the overlord of the kings. The other name after that, Maharaja Adhiraja or Tribhuvana Chakravarti, means the lord of three worlds, and so on. So these were the names those give power to the name of the king. Clear? So what they have told, in spite of such claims, the king, in spite of such claims, they often shared the power with their Samantas. Okay? And they shared their powers as well as with the association of peasants, traders and Brahmins as well. Clear? So, what was their profit with this? So, what happened after sharing these powers? In each of the states, the resources were obtained from the producers. We did a study about this in our last lecture, where the artisans, the cattle keepers, the peasants, they were forced to pay the tax in form of the material they produce. For example, peasants, if they produce some crops, the part of the crop was to be given. If the cattle keeper, if he is having cow, the milk of the cow was to be given to the king. Okay. Or the artisans, if the artisan has a good skill of carving or sculpting, he has to work for a month in the king's court for free. So, like this, the taxes were collected from these people. Okay. Now, apart from this, the revenue was also collected from the traders, the people who were quite rich. From them, the revenue was also collected. So, after collecting the revenue, what did they do? This revenue was used to actually construct temples and forts in their kingdom. clear. They were also, the revenue was also used to buy the arms and ammunitions for the war. You remember in the 6th standard, we learned about Janapadas and Mahajanapadas, how they constructed the forts, how they fortified the forts. Yes. Okay. Now, they used this particular revenue to fight wars, which in turn they expected to lead to the acquisition of the wealth in the form of plunder and access to land as well as the trade routes. Clear? So, they fought war and they created trade routes for themselves by this revenue. So, the functionaries for collecting revenue were generally recruited from influential families, and positions were often hereditary. We did this in our last lecture. If a man is a king, his son will be the king. Clear? If a poet is there in the king's court, the next poet will be his son. Clear? So, this is known as hereditary. So, here we have done with the administration in the kingdoms. Next will be the prasashtis and the grants. What do you understand by the word prasashti, children? Yes? We did prasashti. What do you understand by prasashtis? Last year also we did. It is a written venture, that is a written book by the person who is present in the court, who is hired by the king, and he writes about the king. Clear? About his valor, about his courage, about his winning the war. Everything is written in the prasashti. Clear? So, the prasashti often contain details which may not be literally true, because it is often written in the favor of the king. But it was the book where the rulers wanted to depict themselves as valiant. Valiant is what? Being very courageous and warriors. That is the brave soldiers. That is the reason for portraying that. That is the reason why they wrote prasashtis. These were composed by learned Brahmins. The prasashtis was written by the learned Brahmins who occasionally helped in the administration. So, their work was to write the prasashti only about the king rather than the administration. Clear? So, then what happened more? So, the Brahmins, after writing prasashtis, these particular Brahmins, they were given the grants of land. Clear? As a gift for them writing prasashti for the kings. Okay. So, the Brahmins were given land grants. These were recorded on the copper plates which were given to those who received the land. The picture of copper plates I showed you in our last lecture. Yes, where it has been inscribed that this particular person has got the land from the king. Next point is warfare for wealth. I did give you example about the Pandyas and the Chalukyas. They often raided each other's village, the villages which were more wealthy. Clear? So, their war was for the increasing of the wealth of their kingdom. Clear? So, we did learn about one such example where we studied about the rulers belonging to the Gurjara, Pratahara, Rashtraputa and Pala dynasties fought for control over Kanauj. These three dynasties, they fought for control over Kanauj. Now, because there were three parties, right, for this long-drawn conflict. Conflict is what? Fight. These historians often describe it as the tripartite struggle. That is three parties, that is tripartite struggle. Clear? So, as the rulers try to demonstrate their power and resources by building large temples. So, what happened? The forts and temples, they were given much importance during that era. Now, if one has to showcase their rich heritage, they invest their money, okay, their revenue in building big forts and the temples. So whenever the other dynasty used to attack any dynasty, it was mainly on the temples. Yeah, and one such example also we read about Sultan. Yes, we did read about the Sultan Mahmud. Yes, of Ghazni. He was from Afghanistan. Clear? So how he was? He actually was a very cunning man. Okay. So what he did? He actually captured the northwestern part of the subcontinent. Okay. He raided the subcontinent almost every year. His targets were wealthy temples, including that of Somnath in Gujarat. You remember we did this? Okay. Now, much of the wealth was carried away by Mahmud to create a splendid city in Ghazni, that is in Afghanistan. Okay. So, he was interested in finding more about the people he ruled, he conquered. So, after he found the capable person, one of the capable person he found was the scholar named Al-Biruni, and he was asked to write Kitab-e-Hind. Okay, in Arabic the book's name is Kitab-al-Hind, which was written by scholar Al-Biruni. So who found this particular scholar? Mahmud. Clear? Mahmud of Ghazni. Then what happened after this? The other kings also engaged in this particular war. Clear? We saw about the Chamana ruler also, Prithviraj III. Clear? Who defeated the Afghan ruler named Sultan Muhammad. This is the other example. We read about the Chamana ruler also, that is Prithviraj III. He was defeated by the Afghan ruler named Sultan Muhammad Ghori in 1191, but lost to him the very next year in 1192. So this was the two examples which we studied about the warfare of wealth. So these four points we discussed in our last lecture, children. So let's go ahead and see what the chapter has more to offer us. So let us learn and study about the Chola dynasty in detail. Okay, we did study about them in standard 6th, but this is a more detailed story about the Chola dynasty. A closer look, the Cholas. From where? From Urayur to Tanjore, that comes under South India. How did Cholas rise to power? Let us study that. A minor chiefly family known as the Mutariyar held power in Kaveri Delta. So Kaveri Delta is what, the area near Kaveri River. So this family, Mutariyar family, is a minor chiefly family, a well known family. They were subordinate to the Pallava kings of Kanjipuram. So they were, you know, one of the royal family. So they were the subordinate to the Pallava kings of Kanjipuram. Vijayalaya, who belonged to the ancient chiefly family of the Cholas from Urayur, captured the delta from the Mutariyar in the middle of the 9th century. What do you understand by this? Vijayalaya is the name of a person who belonged to the ancient family of the Cholas. Clear? So he belonged to the Chola dynasty from Urayur. Where we are studying from? Urayur to Tanjore, right? So Vijayalaya, the man, he belonged to a chiefly family, and he was from the Chola dynasty, and he was from Urayur, that is place. He captured the delta, that is the portion, from the Mutariyar in the middle. Mutariyar is what? That is the person belonging to that particular caste. Okay, So this man Vijayalaya, he belonged to the Chola dynasty. Okay, and he captured the delta from Muthaliyar in the middle of the 9th century. He built the town of Tanjavur and a temple for goddess Nishabhasudini there. Clear? So he captured the part of delta from the Muthaliyar in the middle of the 9th century, the Chola king. Clear? And he built a town of Tanjavur and a temple for goddess Nishabhasudini there. Clear? The successes of Vijayalaya conquered neighboring regions. What do you mean by successes? If a man is a king, his son will be the king, then his son will be the king. Correct? So, after Vijayalaya, the successes conquered the neighboring region and the kingdom grew in size. Grew in size, the kingdom expanded and it became more powerful. Clear? Which town did he build, children? Vijayalaya built the town of Tanjavur. Okay? Remember that. The Pandyan and the Pallava territories to the south and the north were made part of this kingdom. So, the Pandyan and the Pallava territories. He was from the Chola dynasty, right? So, the Pandya dynasty and the Pallava territories. Okay, the Pandya territories and the Pallava territories to the south and the north were made part of which kingdom? The Chola kingdom. Clear? So, who did this? The successors of Vijayalaya. Rajaraja I considered the most powerful Chola ruler, became king in 1985 and expanded control over most of these areas. So, Rajaraja I was the successor of Vijayalaya, who took the rule of Chola kingdom. Okay, so he became more powerful as he expanded his control to most of these areas. He also reorganized the administration of the empire. Reorganized, changed the way of working of the empire. Rajaraja's son Rajendra I, okay, Rajaraja's son Rajendra I continued his policies. Whose policies? Rajaraja I, his father's policies. He made a change in the administration, right? So he continued these same policies and even raided the Ganga Valley. First, they raided which valley? The Kaveri Delta, right? Now they raided the Ganga Valley, Sri Lanka and countries of Southeast Asia, developing a navy for these expeditions. So, we can see how the Cholas came into power slowly and gradually. Clear, children? Let us slide ahead. Okay, we saw about the rise of the Cholas. Now we will see the variety of sculptures and variety of splendid temples built in that era. As we learned in our last slide, Vijayalaya, he, you know, made a new kingdom known as Tanjavur, a new town known as Tanjavur. Clear? So, the big temples of Tanjavur and Gangaikonda Cholapuram. Okay, see, this is the temple of Gangaikonda Cholapuram, which you are seeing the image in the right. Okay, the big temple of Tanjavur and Gangaikonda Cholapuram built by Rajaraja. Yes, Rajaraja, he was the father of Rajendra I. We just studied in the last slide. Built by Rajaraja and Rajendra, the father and son, are architectural and sculptural marvels. Marvels are what? wonders, extraordinary. Okay, it's architecture. The work done, the engineering work done, and the sculpting done are extraordinary. Chola temples often became the nuclei of settlements which grew around them. What do you mean by nuclei of settlements? Around the temple, the settlements started settling. People came and they started to live near the temples. These were centers of craft production. I just told you, the people started to come and live near the temple. What activities did they start? They started the centers for craft production. Temples were also endowed with land by rulers as well as by others. Means what? Endowed with land? Land was been donated for building temples by the rulers and as well as others. Others means what? The traders. Okay, those who were rich. The land was been donated by them to build temples. The produce of this land went to maintain all the specialists who worked at the temple and very often lived near it. Clear? So, the produce of this land went to maintain all the specialists at the temple and very often lived near it. The people who were concerned with the temple, they often lived near to it. So, who are they? The priests, the garland makers, cooks, sweepers, musicians, dancers, etc. Clear? So, that particular land which was given to build temple, okay, this land was being given to the people who worked in the temple. In other words, temples were not only places of worship, they were the hub of economic, social, and cultural life as well. Hub of economic means what? We have a hundi in all the temples where we put some dakshina into it, right? So the economy is earned where the temple is maintained. Yes, social is what? Every person comes to temple, clear? So we meet people over there. And cultural, temples are one of the cultural heritage of our country, India. So it is growing in three dimensions. Amongst the crafts associated with temples, the making of bronze images was the most distinctive. Bronze images is what you have seen the bronze structure. If you have your textbook, there is a bronze structure that has been designed by the sculptors. You can see that particular image in your history textbook. Okay, so amongst the crafts associated with temples, crafts is what? Sculpting and architecturing. The making of bronze images was the most distinctive. If you have seen Lord Nataraja's Murti, okay, everybody has seen that, okay, that is the bronze image where I am giving you an example, okay. Chola bronze images are considered amongst the finest in the world. While most images were of deities. Deities, that is, I gave you example of Lord Nataraja, right? So that was a deity. Sometimes images were made of devotees as well. Devotees are who? The person, the people who are more into devotion, more into spiritual field. Sometimes their images were also drawn. Clear? I hope you have understood everything in this slide, children. Clear? Let us go ahead. So next, they worked with the process of agriculture and irrigation to make the town more efficient. Many of the achievements of the Cholas were made possible through new developments in agriculture. So when you look at map 2 again, the map which I have showed you in the earlier state, okay, have a look at that regarding the same. We can notice the river Kaveri branches off into several small channels before emptying into the Bay of Bengal. These channels overflow frequently, depositing fertile soil on their banks. Clear? What happens wherever the soil is fertile, that area leads to the production of agriculture. That is the reason why they have given the small channels before emptying into the Bay of Bengal. They deposit the fertile soil on their banks so that that particular area can go into the production of agriculture. Water from the channels also provides the necessary moisture for agriculture, particularly the cultivation of rice. Although agriculture had developed earlier in other parts of Tamil Nadu, it was only from the 5th or 6th century that this area was opened up for large-scale cultivation. Clear? So, earlier, agriculture was in other parts of Tamil Nadu. Clear? It was developed earlier in other parts of Tamil Nadu, but after the 5th or 6th century, this area was opened up in a larger scale for cultivation. Forests had to be cleared in some regions. Land had to be leveled in other areas. In flooding and canals has to be constructed. So during the flood, canals has to be constructed to carry water into the fields. Many areas, two crops were grown in a year. So you can see the growth of agriculture over here, children, where they extended the cultivation to a large scale, where the forests were being cleaned up for the cultivation of the crops. If the soil was fertile in the forests, they were cleared up and the cultivation of crops started. And then the level was also land in the other areas. If there was flooding, the canals were constructed to carry water into the fields. And in many areas, two crops were grown in a year. So this was a great growth in the field of agriculture. In many cases, it was necessary to water crops artificially. A variety of methods were used for irrigation. In some areas, wells were dug. In other places, huge tanks were constructed to collect rainwater. Remember that irrigation work requires planning, organizing labor and resources. Maintaining these works and deciding on how water is to be shared. Most of the new rulers as well as people living in villages took an active interest in these activities. So not only in the higher production of crops and the outcomes were being put into concentration, but how crops can get water in other ways were also planned accordingly. So in some areas the wells were dug. Clear? In other places, huge tanks were constructed to collect the rainwater, because water has to be carried from different sources. You cannot always rely on underground water. Clear? But what is the thing? Irrigation requires planning, initial planning, yes, organizing labor. In a size of field, how many laborers would work in that particular field? Organizing labor and resources. Resources is what? If you go to pesticides, okay, insecticides, this all comes under resources. See how we are going to buy, how are you going to use them accordingly. and maintaining this works, all these things come into consideration when maintenance comes. This all plays a very important role. And how to share water, clear? If a crop needs less water, if a field needs less water or more water, everything has to be pre-planned, clear? So most of the new rulers as well as people living in villages took an active interest in these activities. Why? They wanted their village to evolve, okay, to change, revolution, a change they needed for that, so that they could acquire more importance for their town, that is Tanjavur. Clear? The agriculture and irrigation part I have explained you clearly. Let us go ahead. Let us see the administration of the empire, children. How was the administration administered? Clear? How the administration was looked upon? Let us see how was the administration organized. What do you mean by organizing? Putting everything in place one by one. Settlements of peasants known as UR. You have studied in standard 6th also. 6th 2. Okay. Settlements of peasants known as UR became prosperous with the spread of irrigation agriculture. Groups of such villages formed larger units called Nadu. For example, Tamil Nadu, right? So, it is a larger unit. Clear? I just gave you an example. Okay? Groups of such villages formed larger units called Nadu. The village council and the Nadu had several administrative functions, including dispensing justice and collecting taxes. So, these two worked together for the villages. Which are the two concerns? The village council and the Nadu. What do you mean by Nadu? Group of villages that form larger units is known as Nadu. Okay. These both, they worked for the administrative functions like dispensing justice, that is giving justice, and collecting taxes. Rich peasants of the Velala caste exercised considerable control over the affairs of the Nadu under the supervision of the central Chola government. Rich peasants are who? Rich farmers of the Velala caste exercised considerable control. They had considerable control. They had power because they were rich, right? They had the major control over the affairs of the Nadu. Affairs means what? The work going under Nadu. Okay. Under the supervision of the central Chola government. Okay. So, this particular caste had a very rich power to see about the work of what Nadu has been doing. Because the Nadu was working along with the village council, but Nadu was been seen, looked upon by the central Chola government. So it worked under the supervision of the central Chola government. So this is how the administration was working. The Chola kings gave some rich landowners titles like Muvindalan. What do you mean by Muvindalan? A Velan or peasant serving three kings. Ariyar means chief, etc. So the Chola kings gave the titles, the heavy titles like Muvinda Velan, that is a Velan or peasant serving three kings. So a particular rich peasant has to serve three kings, or Ariyar, that is chief. As markers of respect, and entrusted them with important offices of the state at the center. Important offices, entrusted them with important offices is what? They gave them the responsibility to to see the important work of the state at the center. We have seen that Brahmanas often received land grants. We did study about it. Yes, they wrote prasastis, and in place of writing the prasasti, they were given land grants, which were inscribed on the copper plates. They received land grants or Brahmadeya. As a result, a large number of Brahmana settlements emerged in the Kaveri Valley as in other parts of South India. Okay, let us slide ahead. So, in the earlier slide, we saw that the Brahmins got the land grants or Brahmadeya. Yes, so each Brahmadeya was looked after by an assembly or sabha of prominent Brahmana landowners. So even the thing that has been given to the Brahmins, that also was been looked upon by the assembly or the sabha, the group of people of prominent Brahmana landowners. These assemblies worked very efficiently, very wisely, very neatly they worked out. Their decisions were recorded in detail in inscriptions, often on the stone walls of temples. Associations of traders known as Nagarams also occasionally performed administrative functions in towns. So you can see to the right hand side where I have posted the picture, where you can see the inscriptions on the stone walls of the temples. Okay, the decisions of the Brahmadeya, okay, or the sabha of the prominent Brahmana landowners, their work, their decisions were recorded. See, you can see in the picture, they were written on the walls of the temples, on the inscriptions, on the stone walls of the temples as inscriptions, they are written in detail. Okay, and at times, the association of traders known as Nagaram also performed, occasionally, sometimes performed administrative functions in the towns. Inscriptions from Uttaramerur in Chengalpatt. Okay, you can see the picture above. That is the picture from the Uttaramerur in Chengalpatt district. Chengalpatt is in South India, Tamil Nadu. Provide details of the way in which the Sabha was organized. So, along with the decisions that was recorded in detail, the inscription also mentioned the way in which the Sabha was organized. The Sabha had separate committees. Which Sabha? The Sabha of prominent Brahmana landholders. That Sabha. Okay. The Sabha had separate committees to look after irrigation works, gardens, temples, etc. Names of those eligible to the members of these committees were written on small tickets of palm leaves and kept in an earthenware pot, from which a young boy was asked to pick the tickets one by one for each committee. So this was the procedure on how they elected the representatives. Okay, so in this entire lesson, we learned about the administration of the kingdoms, new kingdoms. Then we studied about the land grants and prasastis. Yes, we then came to see about the Chola dynasties. We saw about Vijayalaya, where he belonged to the Chola dynasty. We saw about Rajaraja and his son Rajendra, how they expanded the kingdom of Tanjavur, where many sculptures and architectural temples were built. Then we saw about the irrigation facilities, how well they planned out the prominence of agriculture. Yes, and not only that, they knew the delta regions where the soil was very fertile, and they grew kind of crops that were suitable for that particular soil. Clear? Then we saw how the administration was administered, the people who looked after the administration. Clear? this all things we have covered in this entire lesson, children. So I request you to read the whole lesson, and if you have any doubts, you can put in the feedback section. Clear? Let us slide ahead. So I thank you, children, for joining me in this session, and I once again ask you to revise the whole chapter, read the whole chapter, so that you understand it in detail. Clear? So until we meet next time, stay safe, take care, stay fit. Thank you, children.